Good morning, everyone. Let's all stand and begin our worship together. Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be with God, our Creator. Children, all are we. Let us walk with each other in perfect harmony. Let peace begin with me. Let this be the moment now. With every step I take, let this be my solemn vow. To take each moment and live each moment, peace eternally. Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let peace begin with me.
Happy post-Thanksgiving, pre-Advent Sunday. So hope everybody had a meaningful and memorable Thanksgiving with people you love and eating way too much. And our Cowboys are flying right now. How great would it be to win the World Series and the Super Bowl back to back? I'd hate to even start to have that dream. Boy, do they look good on Thanksgiving Day and in the last few weeks, so we're really grateful for that. Any special announcements? Yes, sir.
Yes, my grandson ran 74 yards for a touchdown.
I believe it.
First time that they put him in.
Wow.
They were playing the seniors, and they wouldn't put him in because he's a freshman. Now the coach says, you'll be in there next week.
Yeah. he's kind
of...
Yeah, they're crazy. Did they not see the game tapes of him in high school? He was pretty special. So, well, that's great to hear. Other announcements that we have?
Tell everybody about how you felt and what you went home with.
Well, I felt fine. Everybody's fine. I just hadn't been to an ER visit in a while, so I thought we'd just had some weird feelings last night that wouldn't subside. And, you know, you can't just decide anymore. You can't call your doctor up, so I'm on the app. Giving my symptoms, talking to some AI, probably not even a real person, based on the responses they were giving. And then based on that, we have some concerns, and you should just go to the ER. And then they give me several ERs that we could go to. So we went to the ER, and they did a CT scan, found nothing there. They did a chest scan, found nothing there. So evidently, I'm heartless and brainless, so that was good. I'm glad to hear everything was fine. It was just... It mimics some symptoms of some heart issues, so which I couldn't figure out. But the nausea that I had subsided, so they said we can keep you overnight or send you home. And we were feeling pretty good at the time, so we came home late last night and got a few hours of sleep because I didn't want to miss today. I mean, come on. I look forward to this. And I have to admit, the message that I'm going to deliver is a little odd in the sense that it's, well, it's not odd, it's a very personal message, and probably no better place to give it than with people that are as close as you are. I'd kind of hope some other people would be here, but they may trickle in here in just a few minutes. But anyway, we're glad to be here. I feel better just being with you guys, so that's no better place to be than in the house of the Lord, right, with the people you love the most. So that's great. Any other announcements, anything we need to know? Any update on Eddie? No update on Eddie. He's hoping to get to escape the facility this week.
He's not sick, he's just healing.
He's just stubborn, we've been told. I've been told he's stubborn, so none of you have had a stubborn spouse, so you probably can't relate to that or whatever. So And he's quite bored, I imagine, doing what he's doing. So just continue to pray for Eddie and his continued recovery in that. Well, let's prepare our hearts for worship right now. Come, Holy Spirit, move in us, move among us, move through us. Do a new work in us today. Just continue to call us closer into relationship with you. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the sacrifice you made on our behalf, and we pay attention to that every day of our lives. And we devote our lives to sharing that with others and living it out in all the roles and relationships of our life. Today, may this be a day of renewal. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand for our opening hymn, The Solid Rock.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand.
Let's affirm our faith together by reciting the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Bless the Lord, O my soul, with all that's within me, bless his holy name. And forget not all of your benefits. God, we thank you for the benefits package that we have as believers. We all come to you and into relationship with you from different places, at different ages, and at different stages. But at some point of time, or some period of time, we let go and let you have control and leadership in our lives. And that was the beginning of a brand new life, a transformed life, an exchanged life, where a life condemned to darkness and damnation is given freedom from sin and the guilt of sin, and freedom to have friendship with you and the hope of eternal life. More than just life after life, you give us life during life, an abundant life, a life of abundance where we sense your reality and your relevance every single day of our lives, encouraging us, strengthening us, giving us the ability to carry on in the midst of the daily battle. Just enough for today and enough to trust you for the next day. We pray for each of these that have been mentioned today. Certainly for those that need travel mercies as they're going back to school and all the hustle of the post-holidays. It's going on today. For Eddie, as he continues to recover, we pray for complete recovery of his hip so that he can be restored to as much mobility as possible and get back to doing the activities that he loves to do and most of all ministering to this congregation. For Shelby and for her foot, Lord, for continued healing there. In gratitude for examples like Malik, who could go, well, I've got money now, I've made it, and so I don't need to go back and give, but whose first impulse is to do for others what others had done for him, and to do so with a joyful and cheerful heart. May his example of giving be a practice of our lives as well. For Donna, who struggles with the back issues and certainly needs some care there, we just pray for the strength to carry on, the courage in the short term, and hopefully for a solution medically in the long term. The same thing for Debbie Lahan, who struggled for so long. And for Tom, as he cares for her, we just pray for your continued presence and power to be felt in their life. And for encouragement in the darkness, for joy in moments when they don't expect it, we just pray that you continue to lift up their head and lift up their eyes to you. And for these who are traumatized by either the loss of that occurred in the accident or those who just saw it, there's just the aftermath of that type of trauma that stays with our thoughts. And yet there's a breakthrough moment in that that we'll be talking about later today that can be valuable, Lord. Use that in each person's life. But I pray especially for this husband who's lost his family, that you would surround him with relationships and with a sense of your presence. And if he's not a believer, we pray that he would come to place the whole weight of his life and his burden and his care on you and find in that the release and the comfort that he needs. So Lord, we pray for these things today. I'm thankful so much for all that you've given us, for the hope of heaven, for the forgiveness of our past, for an abundant present. We just give you glory and we magnify you in this moment. These are our prayers to name today in the name of Jesus, who taught us in praying to say, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now may we worship God through the gifts of our tithes and offerings. Stand. God, for all that we've received, it's so easy to give back. Your love compels us. Use these gifts as only you can for your purposes. In Jesus' name, amen. Come thou fount of every blessing. Let's sing together. I love this song.
Come thou fount of every blessing. Tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing. Calls for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount, I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy grace now like a fetter bind my yielded heart to thee. Let me know thee in thy fullness. Guide me by thy mighty hand. Till transformed in thine own image, in thy presence I shall stand. Till transformed in thine own image, in thy presence I shall stand. Thank you. You may be seated.
We go from the violin to the harpsichord, or clavichord. I don't know. I can't tell the difference. I probably don't know the difference between a clavichord and a harpsichord. I know where my clavicle is, but I don't necessarily know where my... But a harpsichord, that's great. That's greatness. Well, three Bible passages that I'm going to try to stitch together. I'll try to weave these together into our message today. So these three passages to think about. Now listen, this is from James 4, 13 and 14. Now listen, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to this or that city, spend a year, carry on business and make money. Why do you not even know what tomorrow will happen? What is your life? You're a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Hebrews 9. People are destined once to die and after that to face judgment. So, as a result, Christ was sacrificed once to take away the sins of many, and he will appear a second time not to bear sin, but to bring salvation to those who are waiting for him. And Mark 10. Whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be a slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. Let's pray. God, use these moments in a way that only you can. More than my words, speak to our hearts what we need to hear at this moment in time. Lift us up, challenge us, encourage us, prod us. Do your work in us, in Jesus' name. Amen. I have three questions at the end of this message that I want to ask myself, that I've been asking myself in recent weeks, and that I want to ask you as we begin this final season of the year. Three questions that I think are relevant in any season of life. They are questions that are heavy on my heart by something that happened to Nancy and me since the last time we saw you. So the message is going to focus on a point of time and on a person in time. It's going to focus on a real perspective-shaking, life-disrupting point in time. And likely all of us at some time with someone have a similar story of the one I'm about to tell you. I mean, we know in life there's always those breakthrough moments. If you live as long as most of us have lived in this room, there are those breakthrough moments that then become pretty seared into our consciousness memories. They bring into sharp focus in an instant. They just kind of cut through it all and bring all the essence of life and living to bear. They shatter any facade that we've created, any false front. They expose it for the silliness that it is, and all that noise and all that busyness and all that smallness that usually consumes our time and our minds. Some of them are public moments, And the bigger ones are usually very personal moments. Public moments, deeply etched in our minds. We remembered the 60th anniversary of one this week on November 22nd, 1963. Most of us who were alive at that time remember precisely what happened the day that John F. Kennedy was assassinated in downtown Dallas. Now, I was just a little elementary age kid in Tennessee, and my mother wasn't even a Democrat. And I came home, and she's sitting at the sewing machine with our black and white console television up on its little legs, sitting there beside watching the news and weeping inconsolably. Really upset me. As a child, you pick up on that level of emotion. I'll always remember that. I can see it. I can sense the emotion in the room on that day. But then there's September 11th, 2001. We all remember that well as well. It just kind of, it was a gut punch, kind of took your breath away. This can't really be happening. Is this real? And the eerie silence overhead when there were no planes in the days that followed that, the terrorist attacks on New York City, Washington, and Pennsylvania. And then there's November 1st, 2023, when we leapt from our seats at the final out of the fifth game of the World Series, when our Texas Rangers, I mean, forever, I'm going to remember, I'm getting goosebumps just thinking about it right now. Those are personal moments that mark our hearts, or those are public moments, but there's also personal moments that mark our hearts probably the most. Sometimes it's soaring moments of joy and triumph. It's a graduation. It's a wedding day. It's the first birth of a child or a grandchild. But all too often, it's agonizing moments of pain and of trauma. The death of a spouse or a close family member or a friend, a divorce, a diagnosis, a disability, a dismissal from work. Well, the three questions that I ask myself today, and I'm going to give to you, arise out of such a real point in time, but they're also about a real person in time, and his name is Steve Jeremski. Steve is my hero in life. Steve is my best friend. He's the best friend I've ever had, and what I'm about to tell you is Steve's story. For the last 36 years, at every holiday, every significant life event, through all the ages and stages, choices and changes, tests and trials, he and his wife have been with Nancy and me in all of it, and we've been there for each other, raising teenagers, releasing adult children, welcoming grandchildren, seeing our parents across the finish line, honoring and loving them to the end. And in recent years, in our empty nest years, it's been talking and texting weekly, daily, getting together regularly for movies and dinner and ice cream and games and just plain old conversation. Nancy and I first met Steve and his wife, Judy, on the second Sunday in September 1987 in Rowlett, when they chose to attend the first service of a new Cumberland Presbyterian church that I had been asked to launch. Judy and Steve had grown up in Detroit, Michigan, raised and educated Roman Catholic. That Sunday was the first time they had ever set foot in a Protestant church. First Protestant service that they had ever been to. Steve was then an electrical engineer with E-Systems, later Raytheon, and recently they had become parents, and through a series of circumstances in their life and exposures to other believers at work, God was doing something in their life, opening them up. And so when volunteers from the presbytery called them about this new church, and then they received mailings that they had agreed to receive in the mail about this new church, they decided to attend the first service, and so our relationship began. Judy's background was as a teacher. She wasn't teaching at the time. She was staying home with her newborn child, but I thought that qualified her, and so I invited her, and she accepted to serve and later lead our children's ministry team in the fast-growing church. Steve's others first and always attitude and his considerable gifts at doing everything I couldn't do, which is building and fixing anything, made him quickly indispensable to me and to the church. They grew in their faith, they grew in their witness, and in their devotion to the ministry and the mission of the new Princeton Park Church. When the church was formally organized as a CP church, Steve became, this Roman Catholic from Detroit, became a founding elder in a Cumberland Presbyterian church. And our friendship deepened. Many years later, after my role at this church ended, they joined us at a non-denominational church in Garland, where I was asked to become the executive pastor and help them grow this plateaued church. And it was an easy and early decision for me to ask Judy to come on staff to lead and to administer our children's program that we renamed Kids Creek. Her passion and talent, through that, the ministry grew to serve hundreds of children and family each weekend in three services, and coordinating, motivating, training, and recruiting nearly 150 volunteers on an annual basis. When my time at that church ended on staff, they remained at the church, and they're still active in that church to this day. And our friendship, though, has continued to grow and deepen, along with a small group of other friends that we've all have from that those years back in Rowlett in those church days. In a true sense, over the last 36 years, they have become more family to me than my real family. I think you'd understand that. If you live a long way from where your family is, there are Christian believers, Christian friends, who become more family to you than your real family. Steve is closer than my own brother to me. In April 1994, I was involved in a car accident that involved a serious head injury in Rowlett. I drifted in and out of consciousness. It was weird because I was able to hear things, but I could not open my eyes. And after a few conscious moments in the ambulance, my next memory was hearing Steve's voice and feeling him touching my leg in the ER of Lake Point Hospital, comforting and assuring me that he and Judy were with me and Nancy. Nancy and I appreciate and love Steve and Judy Jeremski like few people we've ever known. And over the last 15 months, I've never prayed as much for anything or anyone as I have for Steve. In August of last year, 2022, Steve went to bed just like he had every night for 65 years, just like you and I have done and will do tonight. In the middle of the night, he had a sharp pain in his belly. Well, he had had gallstones before, and he thought it felt a lot like that, so he recognized the pain. It didn't go away. Judy drove him to the ER at Methodist Hospital on Bush Turnpike in Richardson, and after running tests, the doctor came in and confirmed Steve's self-diagnosis. Mr. Jeremski, you've got gallstones. But, he said, there's something else that's a major concern. You have a massive abdominal tumor. Moment in time, life changed in an instant. The next day, there was a meeting with an oncologist and a later referral to the renowned MD Anderson Cancer Center, a recognized leader in the treatment of his type of cancer, soft tissue sarcomas. You see, Steve's tumor was not only excessively large, it was unbelievably complicated by its attachment to his vena cava, organs, and muscles in his hip. MD Anderson was needed. What came next was six rounds of the most aggressive chemotherapy possible, using a drug many of you may have heard of called the Red Devil. I mean, it's got to be bad if they're naming it after the devil. Despite the reality they knew going into it, that these types of tumors don't respond well and it may not even shrink the tumor at all, but the purpose was to destroy any cancer cells in his bloodstream or elsewhere in his body. I'm happy to say that our prayers were answered as God gave Steve remarkable stamina and courage, which certainly was uplifting to the doctors and the medical team, to endure this treatment well, except for a few difficult side effects along the way. After he finished the chemotherapy, next was a long stay at MD Anderson for 5 weeks of 5 days a week, targeted radiation that was to be followed by 2 months of rest and recovery before a surgery to remove the tumor. During the time that he was having radiation treatment, unspeakable tragedy struck their family. Their youngest son, Andrew, a 33-year-old corporate HR strategist with Sam's Club Walmart, collapsed while shaving and died immediately of a ruptured brain aneurysm. Treatments were suspended briefly. They came back for the weekend to be with their daughter-in-law and family before returning to Houston to complete the treatments. Finally, after the treatments were completed and the 2 months of rest and recovery to kind of get his body ready for it, they did the surgery. A complicated 11-hour surgery at MD Anderson was performed. that required replacing 5 liters of blood during the procedure. But after the surgery, after recovery, after future scans, it was great news. Our prayers had been answered again. Steve was cancer free, free to live again, free to travel again, free to see his only granddaughter in Utah multiple times, to resume serving in the special needs ministry, which was a real passion for he and Judy at their church, free to start and finish building projects, which he always had a project going, always has had a project going, for his friends and their grieving daughter-in-law, to help also to prepare and to plan for a large celebration of life gathering to remember his son earlier this month. On October 25th, that's just 4 weeks ago last Thursday, Judy and Steve drove up to our house, picked Nancy and I up, and we went to Wiley for a dinner and a movie, and walked around a little bit afterwards in downtown Wiley and just kind of looked at things and had some fun. 2 weeks later, Nancy and I were with Judy and Steve when Steve took his last breath. We released him to the God he loved and served so well, and the joys of heaven that he knew was his promise. So what happened? 2 weeks he's fine, 2 weeks he's dead. 1 week after our outing, Steve got very weak and could not walk across the room without collapsing. Judy took him to his primary care physician, and it showed that his condition had deteriorated to a dangerous level. He was in an urgent need for a blood transfusion due to his low blood count, so they admitted him to the hospital. But this was on a Friday before the celebration of life on what would have been his son's 34th birthday. So determined to attend and speak at his youngest son's memorial service the next day, the transfusion was delayed. He checked himself out of the hospital, went to just the first part of the event. He and Judy unbelievably, masterfully delivered a moving and meaningful tribute to their son and presented a bold and eloquent witness to their faith in Jesus Christ to all who attended, most of whom, I would guess, are not believers. He was immediately driven back to the hospital afterwards, and in the next 2 days, tests confirmed that the aggressive treatments prior to his surgery had resulted in AML. Acute myeloid leukemia. Pneumonia set in, all treatments failed. And at 5 p.m. the next Friday, Steve was placed on a breathing machine as we arrived at the hospital. His wife Judy was told that difficult decisions were imminent. They had just hoped that maybe Steve's remaining son and wife could arrive first before they had to make these decisions, as they had gotten the first flight out to Dallas from Utah. But Steve's heart and ours stopped twice, sending all the staff on the floor into a code blue. Everybody running to his room, working on him for a period of time. Both times, though, his pulse was restored, but his vitals continued to decline. It was clear that his son Matthew would not make it back in time. And Judy courageously honored Steve's wishes. The breathing tubes were removed, and Judy, along with her brother, a church friend, Nancy, and me, were able to be with Steve as in the last 10 minutes he stepped into the presence of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I love Steve, and I miss him so very much. And our hearts break for his wife, Judy, who lost her son 9 months ago and now has lost her high school sweetheart after nearly 44 years of marriage. When I went home that night, I couldn't sleep, obviously. And the Holy Spirit kept bringing to my attention 3 questions that I needed to be able to answer right now, right here. These were the 3 questions. Who could you call at 3 o'clock in the morning for any reason, anywhere, and know without a shadow of a doubt that they'd be there for you? How many people do you have in your life that you can depend on to love and you support, to love and support you no matter why, no matter where, no matter what? Even if I was at Lou Sterrett Jail Steve Jaremski would be there. Now, I realize I'm really preaching to the choir, because I think most of the people in this room, if I called you at 3 o'clock in the morning, would be there. That's the closeness of the community of the saints that we have in this place. Those of you who are newer to this place may not know that, but I have figured out in life, love, and leadership that lone rangers are dead rangers. No matter if you're an introvert or extrovert, we were not built by our Creator to live alone. Without others to help and support and encourage and comfort, a hand to help us out when we need it, to help us up when we need it, a shoulder to lean on, to cry on, an ear to listen, while the mission of the Church of Jesus Christ is clear, to continue His work till He returns to seek and save those who are lost without God. The ministry of its believers to one another is one of amazing support, encouragement, and healing. If you don't know right now that you could pick up the phone and call anybody or text anybody in this room or somebody else, if you don't have at least three people, then that needs to be a wake-up call for you. The second question that came to mind, looking at Steve's life, is my life one of service or selfishness? Is it all about me? Or do I wake up thinking about other people? Is your life all about you, or is it all about other people? I read to you the words of Jesus in Mark. Whoever wants to be great among you must be a servant. Whoever wants to be first must be a slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give His life a ransom for many. Greatness based on usefulness, that's the concept that Jesus let loose in the world, both by His expression and by His example. Incarnate love, love with flesh shown in action, by serving others. Steve's last public act was one of amazing love and testimony at the celebration of his son's life, even though he was at death's door. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, "Let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify your heaven, your Father in heaven." Are you letting your light shine? This is a hard one for me because I'm a pessimist by nature and I can be a little more of a dark cloud than a shining light. But am I a light to others, or am I that dark? Am I a maximizer? Am I a diminisher? Do I see every encounter, everybody that I lock eyes with, even that person cutting me off in whatever lane I happen to be in, do I see that person as a person for whom Jesus died, a person whom Jesus thought was worth dying for? Am I adding value to others every day in every action, in every reaction, in every interaction? The question is, am I living for myself or for others? Zig Ziglar says, you can have everything you want in life if you help enough other people get what they want. Every day we should be asking ourselves, it doesn't matter your age and stage, it doesn't matter your level of mobility or whatever your health situation is, your first question when you get up in the morning is, Lord, what's the best use of the rest of my life? And because we're at the age and stage that many of us are, Lord, what's the best use of today? And then be immediately obedient. Any sense of the whisper or prompting of the Spirit of God in your life, do it. Be obedient. Engage a person. Ask a question. Send a text. Make a call. Share a compliment. A kind word. Give a handshake. A hug. Whisper a prayer. Let them know you're praying for them. Love God and live for Him in all the roles and relationships of your life. So question two, is my life about service or is it about self? The last question was really hard, and that was, if I knew I only had 2 weeks to live, do I have every assurance that I'd go to heaven? If you knew that in 2 weeks you'd be dead, just like Steve, not having any idea 2 weeks before he died that he was even sick, do you know for sure you'd go to heaven? That was the question that was asked of me over 50 years ago when I first came to faith. If you were to die tonight, do you know for sure you'd go to heaven? Is your everyday life one of abundance that's full of this reality of God and of His relevance with this confident hope of eternal life when this life is over, where our faith becomes sight and where all that we don't know will be known and all life's questions understood? When Steve and and Judy were watching Killers of the Flower Moon and eating Italian food with Nancy and Wes Johnson, did he have any idea he'd be dead in 2 weeks? No, but what he did know, because we talked about it many times, and especially during his illness, Steve knew God's will is always good, right, and pleasing, even if it means death. And he surrendered to it during all times and trials of his life, including this dreadful diagnosis and everything that came after it. I hate death. I can't tell you how many times I've said those words. I hate the indignity of it all. I hate the unspeakable pain it causes. But I love God more. Because the Bible's told us that Jesus has destroyed death. So that for believers, looking beyond death's door, looking at the dying process, looking at all of that, death has no mastery or even mystery for the believer because, as the Bible says, in Jesus, he's brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. He went through the grave, came back, and showed us there is eternal light possible. To live is Christ and to die is gain. That the worst thing for most people is actually the best thing for the believer in Jesus Christ. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me, that person doesn't die. He's the Lord of life. He's the Lord of death. He's the Lord of life after the death. We are not in the land of the living waiting to pass over to the land of the dying. We're in the land of the dying waiting to pass over to the land of the living. And amen goes here. Watching someone you love die, if you've never done it before, is one of the most excruciating acts of service we can do in this life. But letting them go into the presence of God is one of the most blessed and joyous gifts. How could we delay or deny anyone we love the best for which they lived long and loved? Faith in Jesus, the God of Jesus, is the best way to live and the only way to die. So, deaths like these, and we've had many in this congregation recently, can be a wake-up call that none of us are going to get out of this alive. The statistics, by the way, is that there's 100% mortality rate for all of us. Now, how's that for being a ray of sunshine today? We have a ray of sunshine over here, but that's not me. You know, it's just these moments, they just break through all the pretend that we have, and they remind us of our inescapable mortality and how fragile life is. We're a heartbeat from eternity. That family driving on the freeway had no idea that that would be the last day of their life. So the question lingers. Am I ready? Are you ready? I just want you to pray over these questions. Is my life an act of service or an act of selfishness? How many people do I know? Have I built such relationships of depth and intimacy with them that I know I could text them for any reason, anywhere, and they'd be there at 3:00 in the morning? And most importantly, if I were to be dead 2 weeks from now or tonight, are you certain you'd go to heaven? I want you to think about that as you listen to this song that we're going to play right now, and then we'll close the service.
How I long to breathe the air of heaven, where pain is gone and mercy fills the streets, to look upon the one who bled to save me and walk with him for all eternity. There will be a day when all will bow before him. There will be a day when death will be no more. Standing face to face with he who died. Holy is the Lord. stand beside the heroes of the faith. Oh, with one voice, a thousand generations sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Stand, close your eyes, and let's pray. God, I thank you that though I'm fallen, finite, and fouled up, in your grace and in your goodness and your generosity, you have surrounded me with so many people that I know without a shadow of a doubt that if Nancy or I called them at any time of day or night for any reason, anywhere, they'd be here. And most of the people in this room fall into that category. My heart grieves for people that don't have that level of joy and intimacy with people. God, I declare today that I want my life to be one of service, not selfishness. I know the gravitational pull of my life is to always do what I want to do, when I want to do it, how I want to do it. I wake up naturally thinking that. But Lord, I want to intercept that. And every day, through the power of your Holy Spirit, I want to get up and ask, what's the best use of today? I want to see people differently. I don't want to see them as people that are doing bad stuff or people that aren't helping me in any way. I want them to see them as people for whom you were willing to die and find a way to give encouragement or light in the midst of that person's life. It's amazing to me, Lord, that my best friend Steve left in his will that he doesn't want to have a funeral. He just wants everybody to go and enjoy a meal at his favorite restaurant on the border. Chips and salsa on Steve. Even in his last dying wishes, he's wanting other people to find joy, not to make it about him. And Lord, I remember so well in that little country church over 50 years ago when your Holy Spirit spoke deeply to my heart and help me know that I had been in church my entire life, that I did not have the certainty that if I were to die that night, I would go to heaven. And at that moment, I put a stake in the ground and said, from this point forward, I walk with you. I'm stopping walking for me. I trust you completely for my salvation. And I receive your gift of abundant and eternal life. If you don't have that assurance today, I encourage you to put a stake in the ground right now. November 26, 2023 is the day I accepted God's gift of eternal life. How do you do that? Romans 10. If you declare with your mouth, Jesus is my Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it's with the heart that you believe and are justified, and it's with the mouth that you profess and are saved. If you've already made that confession at some time in your life, then the enemy of the good God is doing in your life is placing that sense of doubt. You just need to go and rely on the facts of Scripture, not on the feelings that you have. And yet there's never a bad time to recommit ourselves to making God Lord of our lives. So Lord, if there's anybody here today that wants to plant that stake, I just pray that they would say right now, in the quietness of their own heart, Lord, forgive me for what I've been, forgive me for what I've done, forgive me for making it all about me. I believe that you died on the cross to forgive me all of my past and to give me an abundant present and an eternal future. And I accept your invitation. And I ask you to come into my life, take control of my life from this day forward. Every day is lived for you. It sounds that simple, because it is that simple. And at that moment, your gift of the Holy Spirit, God, we know, comes into our life and begins a brand new work in us. God, we thank you for this day. I thank you for the goodness of these people. I thank you for the health to actually be here today when I wasn't certain last night. And I even thank you for death and for the way it wakes us up and makes it real with all of us. To you be all the praise and honor and glory, now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you very much. We are going to sing a closing hymn. They'll know we are Christians by our love.
We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. And we pray that all unity will one day be restored. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will walk with each other, we will walk hand in hand. We will walk with each other, we will walk hand in hand. And together we'll spread the news that God is in our land. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will work with each other, we will work side by side. We will work with each other, we will work side by side. And we'll guard each one's dignity and save each one's pride. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. To the Father, from whom all things come, and all praise to Christ Jesus, his only Son, and all praise to the Spirit who makes us one. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
I realize this was a heavy message, so I want to send you out with some light. Obviously, it's a good day. It's a great day. And you have great people, probably a two-hug minimum at least, probably before you leave, because you know these people are people you can count on. So those of you who haven't been here as long, I guarantee you, you don't have to know these people long to know they're there for you. That's the strength of this community. Now, I've been part of churches that have tens of thousands coming this weekend to them, but sometimes that crowd, there's anonymity in it. Here, there's no anonymity. We know when you're not here and you're missed. And we care about what's going on in your life. So God bless you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with us all. Amen. Go out and be a light to others.